Frauds, fakes, and scammers, just a few of the unwanted and costly side effects of America's pandemic response. While a once-in-a-century pandemic tore its way through our country, killing thousands, sickening millions, and pushing our public health system to the breaking point, a group of grifters, profiteers, and wannabe entrepreneurs saw their chance to get rich, and it all came at our expense. The story of these wildcat capitalists is the subject of a new book. It's called Pandemic, Inc., Chasing the Capitalists and Thieves Who Got Rich While We Got Sick. And I'm delighted to welcome its author, investigative journalist J. David McSwane, to Frank Buckley Interviews. David, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
This is not a happy book. It's not a book about the country coming together and overcoming some collective challenge. It's a book about failure, a national failure. You write about your experience reporting this book in this way. Let me share this quote with our viewers and our listeners. I saw an ugliness that hides beneath our national mask. I saw greed masquerading as entrepreneurial spirit, selfishness as rugged individualism, opportunism as patriotism, recklessness as bravery. I saw hope as well and love, but someone else can write that book. Strong words. What prompted you to write those words?
Yeah, that was actually one of the later sentences I wrote in the book as I was trying to summarize almost 2 years of reporting following around, you know, in the early months, those buccaneers and pirates, as one of the characters in the book refers to them, people who, you know, lied or you know, scammed the federal government to get rich at the expense of, you know, taxpayers. But also just sort of trying to take in the moment, those two years we've just endured, really call into question, you know, our country and what we want to be and how we behave and how we treat each other.
You begin the book with a moment that really seemed like dark comedy that draws the reader in as you go on a private jet plane ride with a guy that makes you think, really, this is happening and we're paying for it? Tell us about who you took a jet plane with and what that ride was about.
Sure. So this was about 2 years to the week, actually. I was trying to find my place in COVID coverage. I'm here in Washington, D.C., fairly new to ProPublica, and just decided to follow the money, taking a look at the contractors who were coming out of the woodwork as the federal government was really, it appeared to be panic buying. And honed in on the Veterans Administration, which oversees the largest hospital network in the country, and looked at their top contractor who got a deal for $6,000,095, a $34.5 million deal, and just started to look into this contractor, Robert Stewart Jr., and came to find he had no real footprint. He'd never had a federal contract before. There were some questionable things on his website, some plagiarism, and just decided, you know, I'm gonna call him and see how he got these things. And when I got a hold of him, he said, you know, I'm the real deal. I have 6 million masks. I'm hopping on a private jet in the morning to oversee their delivery outside of Chicago. And I said, well, that's an incredible story. Would you mind if I tagged along? And a few hours later, I'm on a private jet, and it was right as literally as we were taking off from Dulles International that he revealed he didn't actually have the masks. He said someone had bought them out from under him, but he's working in this sort of daisy chain of brokers and investors who are behind the deal. And it was really my entree into this underworld of people who were trying to get, you know, a vig on these major deals coming out of the federal government and states, and sort of racking up the price and wasting time.
And it would be funny, and the way it's written, you kind of chuckle. And then you start to think, wait a minute, that's my money that the government is spending to pay for these 6 million masks that don't exist, or that this guy doesn't have a hold of. What happened to all that money? Did he ever get the masks?
So in the case of Robert Stewart Jr., he actually wasn't paid because he didn't deliver. Hmm. So the federal government, their defense was, well, first they said they were vetting contractors, and we proved that was clearly not true. It did not take a lot of research to find out they were hiring all sorts of unsavory characters. But their defense was, well, we didn't actually pay for the mask, so no harm, no foul. But what they had done was really throw jet fuel onto the fire of this sort of bonanza to get rich, because they just broadcast to this network of investors and mask brokers that they were willing to pay nearly $6 a mask. In other instances, there were contractors who were paid even though they delivered nothing or, you know, delivered subpar goods.
And is there any way to quantify that? How much of our money, taxpayer dollars, ultimately went to nothing?
We're going to be catching up to it for a long time. It was so big. It was so messy. We may never truly be able to put a dollar figure on it. But the thing, you know, we report on government waste all the time. It's in the headlines every week. This was much bigger and frankly, kind of clownish. But the real cost was time. These were crucial weeks when we needed to catch up on testing. We needed to get supplies to nurses and doctors. People were dying, and wasting that time cost American lives. Mm.
Let's go back to Robert Stewart Jr. for a second. How is it that he's able, without any federal contracts to date, convince the government, hey, that I'm the guy who can deliver these masks for you? Give me $34 million.
My suspicion early on was that the federal government was giving contracts out to anyone with an LLC and an email address. And it sounded absurd, but my research bore this out. Robert Stewart Jr. got that deal simply by emailing a contract officer at the Veterans Administration. And emails I got through the public records law revealed that a contract manager said, "This guy seems legit." And that's how he got the deal. In normal times, there'd be a bidding process and all of that. It was that willy-nilly because we were unprepared. We didn't have what we needed in the stockpile. And, you know, the Trump administration had tried to downplay the pandemic. So there was this mad rush to catch up. And, these mercenaries seized advantage.
And we'll get into that in just a second. But I want to ask you about another incident that you write about in a warehouse in Texas, where people are trying to pass off plastic tubes used to make soda bottles as medical test tubes. Tell us how you found out about this operation and the people behind this one.
Yeah, so at ProPublica, we decided to sort of team up and just get a story out. Something like $1 billion had been given to completely new and untested contractors just in those first 2 months. So we just put out a little story quantifying that. And there was a company that I focused in on called Filikit LLC. They had formed in late April or early May, and 6 days later had a $10 million contract with the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Pretty remarkable turnaround. And looking into the company, they had no footprint in medical supplies whatsoever. These were the PCR tests that require a little bit of laboratory work and science. So we were skeptical that they could deliver these test kits, which weren't in mass production yet. And, come to find out that the owner had a history of fraud allegations and had been sued by the Federal Trade Commission for, some alleged scams. We were skeptical. So we just put them in a story. And I happened to be in Texas and I get a call from a state public health official who says, "I'm familiar with this company. We got their test tubes. They're completely unusable. I didn't know what they were. It's going to set back testing in my state." I showed them to a colleague who realized that these are not test tubes. They're mini soda bottle preforms that with, heat and pressure are blown up to become your 2-liter soda bottles at the grocery store.
Wow.
And they were just thrown into these bags. They're supposed to be hermetically sealed, so they're clearly sterile. They can't be used. So I just decided to pop into their warehouse outside of Houston, and I saw and took some video. Workers were using literal snow shovels to gather up these little soda bottles from large bins to put them into smaller bins. Workers, some of whom were wearing masks, many weren't, were just squirting saline in and throwing them into these bags and throwing them on a truck, and they were unsterile. So when I told the Federal Emergency Management Agency about this, they had already delivered these test kits, these useless test kits, to all 50 states and territories. And they had to tell state health workers, "You can't use these tests." So it set back testing at a really crucial time. We were already behind, and it prevented us from getting ahead of the virus in those really scary months.
And in some ways, one might think, okay, the government was doing the best it can or it could under the circumstances. This was an emergency. It was a pandemic. We weren't prepared for this. But isn't the federal government supposed to be prepared for this?
Oh, certainly. I mean, and I have some empathy for the poor contract workers who are used to buying chairs and paper clips, and they're suddenly arbiters of life-saving equipment. Mm-hmm. It was an unprecedented situation, and it was stressful for everyone involved. But had the federal government and both the Obama and Trump administrations heeded earlier warnings, we would have been better prepared. We had something like 1% of what we needed in the strategic national stockpile in terms of masks and gloves, those like really initial, life-saving countermeasures. So we were flat-footed. The virus hits, and then you add to that the Trump administration's efforts to downplay it. So by the time we tried to catch up, our national well-being was put in the hands of these mercenaries, and it's just not a situation we should be in.
All right, we're going to take a short break. We're going to come back in just a moment with investigative reporter J. David McSwane.
So that means that you'd have to have a long-term contract from the government in order to do it.
Yeah. Listen, we've gone from one shift to three, 80 people to 200. We're making four times the products we made. We're making over 1 million masks a day. Don't you look at me and act like I'm sitting on my and not firing up four machines. It's not like just turning on a switch.
Welcome back to Frank Buckley Interviews. We're back with ProPublica investigative journalist J. David McSwane. He's the author of the new book, Pandemic, Inc., Chasing the Capitalists and Thieves Who Got Rich While We Got Sick. David, not everyone in the book is a villain. There are some decent people you encountered during your reporting. One of them is the man we just heard, Mike Bowen. We played that clip of his testimony before Congress in 2020. Who is Mike Bowen? Why was he so upset during that congressional testimony?
Yeah, Mike Bowen runs, he's since retired, but he ran a domestic mask factory down near Dallas, Texas, one of very few left. And he had been warning the federal government, the three presidential administrations for 13 years, that if we're hit with a pandemic, China's going to choke off supply. Everything had been offshore to China for cheaper production and manufacturing. We're going to be in a lot of trouble. The U.S. needs to fill the stockpile with domestic masks and needs to invest in that infrastructure, or we're going to be in a lot of trouble. And I was really drawn to him, not just because he's a character, he's got a little bit of Texas in him, but because he really saw the writing on the wall. And he was one of the first people to call the alarm. He had seen in early January from an obscure corner of his company's website that N95 purchases were going through the roof, and people buying them appeared to be Chinese Americans who might be sending them back home. And we were all hearing about this novel coronavirus at the time. And he really set off a chain of events in Washington by communicating with bureaucrats here who, had they listened to him, could have invested in firing up domestic manufacturing of masks so that we weren't reliant on China, which was holding back, and these mercenaries who were price gouging and trying to get rich. So he really tried to do it right. And then he ends up sort of getting raked over the coals by Congress because they said, well, why didn't you just fire up these N95 machines? And it wasn't that simple. There's red tape. His company had nearly gone bankrupt after H1N1, the swine flu in 2010, because they had hired a bunch of people and ramped up production, but the federal government investment went away. So they had to lay off 150 employees. He didn't want to end up in that situation again. He wanted the stockpile to commit to beefing up domestic supply. So he was sort of a nuanced character who really got a bad rap in the press, I think. Mm.
Another person who tried to raise the alarm early is Dr. Rick Bright. You write about Dr. Rick Bright. He was the head of the Biomedical Advanced Research and Development Authority. What was his role in the response to the pandemic?
Yeah, so he ends up filing a famous whistleblower complaint. But before that happens, he had developed a relationship with Mike Bowen. And these guys are pretty different people. Mike Bowen's not afraid to cuss before Congress. Rick Bright's a pretty staid bureaucrat. But they'd formed a friendship because they understood the risk. They understood we were not ready for a pandemic. And Bowen ends up communicating with Rick Bright, who's within Health and Human Services. He's overseeing, he can't even buy masks. He's overseeing, you know, things like vaccine development. But Rick Bright starts agitating in Washington, trying to get the Trump administration to start doing things. And he's ignored and ultimately sidelined. So these two really saw what was coming. They tried to get things moving, and political interference got in the way.
And there's a moment when Peter Navarro enters the picture, and people sort of may know him from his trade positions with China. He's actually one of the first in the administration to recognize COVID-19 for what it is. Can you speak to Peter Navarro's position in all of this?
Yeah, Peter Navarro, as you said, Trump's trade advisor, really a character. Everyone in Washington has an opinion about him. A lot of people don't like him, but he's a China hawk. And, you know, by virtue of that, he paid attention to some supply chain things. He understood that we were in a lot of trouble and that this virus was going to be a big deal. And he was trying within the White House to spur action. And, he wasn't being listened to. He got frustrated. He wanted things done in what he called Trump time. And he did something remarkable to try to get, to try to get things moving. He really took over federal purchasing. I began to see deals that were ordered by the White House. And you can't have, politicians or political appointees awarding contracts and picking winners and losers for obvious reasons. But he didn't care. So he got in the middle. He was trying to steer things, spending money, ramping up. So he was in this weird spot where he could have been a hero, but he sort of gets in his own way. And I began to see him as a little bit of a tragic figure. His fanaticism about China and his politics and focusing on things like hydroxychloroquine really diminished the good work he nearly did.
As a reporter, as you're filing these Freedom of Information Act requests, as you're getting these troves of documents, as you're starting to look through these purchase orders and the emails back and forth, were you astonished? Did you think, wait a minute, how come any people aren't talking about this?
Yeah. Well, I instinctively understood that the moment we were going to do what's called emergency spending, that people were going to take advantage. That's why I decided to look into it. I've covered contracting at various levels of government for a long time, and I knew it was going to be messy. But I was astounded at the breadth of the fraud and the complete negligence on behalf of the federal government to really vet these vendors. We've seen fraud throughout history in crises. The reason we have the False Claims Act is because of fraud during the Civil War, for instance. But this was really massive. This was a wide scale. And typically fraud is perpetrated by, business to consumer or business to business. It's rare that you see such brazen fraud committed against the government, because the government takes notes. They have auditors. We have comptrollers, things like that. So there was something different about this moment. People really thought they could get away with it, and in fact, some have. But many people are going to jail. So I was really just astounded at the complete lack of oversight and leadership. And people took cues from that and tried to take advantage.
All right, we are going to take one more short break. When we get back, more with ProPublica investigative reporter J. David McSwane. Welcome back to Frank Buckley Interviews. We're having conversation with J. David McSwane. He's an investigative reporter with ProPublica and the author of the new book, Pandemic Inc. I just want to pick up on a thread, David, that you mentioned a moment ago, that people are going to jail, paying a price for some of the things that have happened. Can you give us a sense of that? And also, within our government, has there been any accountability for those who were incompetent or who didn't do the right thing?
Sure. Yeah, I don't want to give too much away, but one of the main characters in the book, Robert Stewart Jr. with the private jet, was ultimately charged with three federal crimes and is in prison for those crimes. Many other contractors, you know, got away with it. They had their contracts canceled, but, you know, didn't face criminal penalties. The Biden administration, actually in the president's State of the Union, he announced a special prosecutor for pandemic fraud. So they're really trying to catch up to this. And a lot of that was within the Paycheck Protection Program, the money to small businesses to pay employees and so forth. There was just rampant fraud in that program. So it's going to take a while, but we should see some consequences, you know, as prosecutors build those cases. Within the federal government, there is a congressional inquiry that's digging these things up slowly, but we haven't seen a lot of accountability, you know, as they're focused on things like January 6th.
What about structurally within the government? This really exposed the fact that we were not prepared as a government for a pandemic. Now, this many years later, this many lives lost later, are we in a better position to deal with the next pandemic?
If we were hit with one in the near future, I think we'd be a little more prepared just by virtue of the experience we've all been through. There are some things that are coming. The president has called for something like $88 billion to be invested in the health and human services apparatus, which includes the CDC and FDA, and has proposed tweaks there. So one hopes that that'll make us a little bit more prepared. At the very least, we have shored up supplies, and it is painfully obvious that we need to have domestic manufacturing of those early countermeasures so that we're not reliant on these buccaneers and pirates that I detail in the book. And I hope the book is really a blueprint of exactly what we shouldn't do the next time around.
Well, the book, once again, is Pandemic, Inc., Chasing the Capitalists and Thieves Who Got Rich While We Got Sick. J. David McSwane is the author. Terrific bit of reporting. David, thank you very much for this.
My pleasure.
And my thanks to you for watching. I hope you'll join us on the audio podcast later this week, where we will continue the conversation.